Hello everyone, welcome to Mau Mau Arts TV Season 2, where we showcase and feature various personalities and key spaces. We are glad you're here to join us and please subscribe. Welcome.
Hi. I'm so sorry. I'm really not tech savvy. Every time I think I have my shit together, I don't.
Nice to see you, though. I hope you're doing
nice
good.
Nice to see you, too. I'm good.
Yeah.
I'm good. Sorry, let me just plug this in because I had to move the computer. Okay. We're good.
Yeah.
How are you?
I'm good. So nice to again see you. The first time I saw you like off screen is the filmmakers event, the African Women Filmmakers event.
Yeah. And you just dropped some bombs and then left.
No.
Is this guy coming back? I'm going to be just done.
Okay.
But nice to see you. I mean, do you always wake up like that? It's like you look so good all the time.
No. I don't know. No. In fact, this is just my excitos because I was under the weather for a few days.
Okay.
Now I'm alive. I'm like, wow. Yeah. There's a world I can live out there again. I mean,
how is it?
Look a bit nice.
But how is it? How's the weather in Nairobi? As you can see, some of us are like dying of heat. Yeah.
The weather is mad. It has lost its nuts. It doesn't know what it's doing.
Hot or cold, or it's mixed.
Both. That's the thing, because it's looking hot, but then there's a breeze. That's you're wondering whether you're actually in Kenya or where you are. It is so cold, but it's just fake sun. So I don't know.
I mean, I've been really following your work because, you know, like we are filmmakers as well. I'm a filmmaker, I'm a film director, I'm a writer.
Yeah.
So I am a prolific watcher of movies. I'm a movie buff.
Yeah. As it should be.
Yeah. So even like way before I even began, I'm a visual artist, but even before I began now film work about close to 8 years ago, I was really heavy into watching movies, and that's how I actually got to first see you on Mali.
I want to start a family trust that will benefit all.
It's fair enough.
But before I do, I want to give 10% to the church.
What? Bishop, you cannot let her tithe all that money. Then I cannot let her just give it away.
She is not giving it away. She is tithing.
What's the difference?
I saw you. I think that's the first time I saw Mumbi Maina.
That's the first time most Kenyans saw Mumbi Maina.
Yeah, and it was, I loved it so much. I loved your performance. I loved the ensemble. Whoever did the casting, I think it was an Alison Ngibuini production.
Yeah.
It was good.
It was spot on. It was thorough and intense. And we did that in mini auditions. I think it was over a span of like 2 weeks before they could now decide which character is which. It was really intense.
Yeah.
they nailed it once they got everyone together.
Yeah. And I'm seeing you've been doing some really big things, and I'm so humbled by the fact that we are finally getting to a point where Kenyans are hitting the international market, because before it was few and far between.
Yeah. It's about time.
Yeah, so maybe you can just quickly, I know you, like with you, I could even take 3 hours, but we have a short time. So maybe you can just tell me, I know you are a dancer at some point. So maybe you could just tell me how you cascaded that into film, like being a dancer and then now you're an actor. And now it's like, we know you predominantly as an actor. Very few people, I mean, like I had to go online and do some personal research. I heard in one of your interviews you saying that you're actually a dancer. So how did you kind of segue into the film industry?
It wasn't planned, that's for sure. But the interesting thing is, someone who from church back in the day, who used to know that I used to choreograph, saw me at this audition. Now, I wasn't going for the audition. I was taking my sister for it because she's more of a theater person. She was in Saints, she was in Songari. So even though they did a lot of theater those days, especially in school. So I wasn't really an actor. I knew I could dance. I mean, cool. I mean, dance, no problem. But her intuition was just on point. And she just gave me this look and she kept saying, why don't you try? And I was like, cameras, it's a no for me, but thanks for trying. And she just said, have fun with it and see how it goes. And my sister was very adamant. She said, she's not leaving until I try. And literally, that's how I stumbled into film. So yes, it was someone who'd seen me dancing before who thought that they should try and give me a shot in acting.
Okay.
And that's how I got into film. Yeah, so we did the film. It's called Unseen, Unsung, Unforgotten. It wasn't really seen anywhere. Unseen, Unsung, and Forgotten.
Was it a feature or a short?
It was a feature.
A feature, okay.
Feature, yeah, and it was right before post-elections. Yeah, so that was my wonderful initiation into the film industry, and we're also not paid. So that was another great... I was working, doing administration in the corporate world, in different companies. And I could not stop thinking about acting. I just could not. And I had a small little epiphany where I asked myself, if I had all the money in the world, what would I be doing?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, ooh, there's nothing else. I mean, when I was on set every single day, even on days I wasn't supposed to be on set, I was there just because I loved the environment. I loved being around filmmakers. I loved seeing and watching and learning. I got the bug and it's never left me since.
Yeah,
so it's my transition.
Nice. And I think that's like a real, it's the story of many people where you don't kind of transition from what you feel you need to be doing for the rest of your life and you start to get stuck in a rut. And I think like based on your filmography and everything you've been doing, as they say, the rest is history. Because imagine if, for example, you maybe did not take that leap of faith and said, maybe let me just be an admin. It's safe. Maybe I know this more. It's more familiar to me than the unknown. You would not be in Mali. You'd not be in all the films you've been in, all the shots you've been in, all everything you've done. Basically, your career in film would be like rewritten if you didn't have that courage to just make that step. And it makes me wonder whether you faced any form of obstacles, be it in the form of situations or people at the time you were making that transition. Maybe were there people who talked you down? Were there people who encouraged you? Were there people who said, I Kenya yetu hakuna kazi ya actors?
I got all of the above. Long and short of it. Like, there's nothing you missed out there. I'm like, I kept it to myself for most of the time. Okay. I only told people who I felt very safe with, who I felt would actually encourage me. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough, some of the people at the office I was working at the time, I was an investment bank.
Okay.
And they used to laugh and say, well, you're always rebelling one way or the other. Either it's your hair or your nails or something, because it's like there's a creative bug that's trying to get out and it's just not matching with the rest of the office.
Yeah.
So truly, I was just like, yeah, I think this is a sign.
Yeah.
But my family didn't at first fully understand it. And I think the people around me to a lot of extent thought that this is fun for a side thing. Mm-hmm. But like, you're not gonna let go of everything else, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, but I am. So that was quite interesting. But I think they also know me well enough to know that I'm not very good at being told what to do.
Yeah.
It's hilarious that I'm an actor and that is my life, being told by a director what to do. Shout out to every director who's handled my madness. Yeah, but I think the most challenging part was actually when I got into the industry, just breaking in. I think I came in something that was just different, and I don't think anyone really understood what was happening.
Maybe a dancer? What?
Sorry, it's just... I've seen you dance in the Roomba.
And?
And And it's interesting.
Don't kill my vibe. Are you trying to say I'm a bad dancer?
No, you're great.
Learn not to bad yourself.
Dance persons.
Oh, now I feel cheated.
Don't be. First I wanted to be a ballerina. Then I wanted to do jazz, then I wanted to do tap. Hence the dance lessons. My dad always let me do what I wanted to do.
You see that like it's a bad thing?
Anyone's
and it's good you didn't anyway, because I mean, if you did, you'd not have like made the steps to pursue that, and likewise these opportunities and the growth you've had would not have happened. So yeah, it's good you remain steadfast in what you wanted to do and stuck to that. I actually saw some earlier work of yours. I think it was pre-Mali. If I'm not wrong, Mali is around 2012 thereabout.
Yeah,
I saw one called Shattered. I found that really interesting.
Shattered.
Yes, and the funny thing is, most people who know Mumbi Maina don't know, would not reference Shattered. But personally, maybe because I'm a film buff or something, or I'm a director, I tend to believe that performance, though part of your early portfolio, was actually quite good.
Yeah, I did after Unseen and Something Forgotten. Okay. So I did about the same time as Mali, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Mali was actually, I liked your character in Mali. It was Nandi, right?
Chaos. Nandi Mali, aka Chaos.
Yeah.
You have no guts to fight for our family.
Well, it's a good thing that you have all the guts, Nandi, so you can go out there and fight for us.
Yeah. But how was it on set with the likes of Mkamze? And the rest?
Equally chaotic. I feel like I learned so much from her, because I mean, she's been there for forever. And I didn't really know her prior, because I didn't actually know jack shit about the industry. I really didn't know.
I was married to Gregory Mali, and Gregory Mali did not entertain weak women.
You want me to tell Mabel to steal from God?
Oh, please, don't patronize me. I mean, you steal from God all the time.
So I really appreciated just how passionate she is about the art and how much she enjoys actually drawing things out of other actors. Like, she will see something, and instead of, some actors I know can be a bit selfish and not care, but I appreciate that she had the capacity to be like, okay, I can see there's something here. Let's go with it. Let's fly with it. And I learned a lot from that set. All of us were green.
Yeah. And I mean, you have the talent, because I mean, if you are green, and what I mean, I think there's people undermine the role of passion, because if nothing else, from the outset, you have been passionate, and green or not, you only move away from that with passion, and that's why you are not green anymore. And that's why, like, right now, you're able to kind of look back and appreciate some of these roles. So even like, I would ask you, maybe if you are to pick one, I know sometimes you're spoiled for choice, but if you're to pick one of the small screen roles to include short films that for you was quite memorable, which one would it be?
Wow, that's a tough one. It's a tough one because almost every role every role I've chosen, whether it was consciously or subconsciously, were because I love them. So I love something about that character. That's a tough one. La Femme Anjola, there's a movie that I did again with Dominic recently.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and it's, you don't know? You movie buff? Oh my goodness.
Was it marketed locally, or is it a Kenyan
show? No, not really.
Okay.
No. It's fully Nollywood. So it's the second doing it with them. So the character I was playing is called Habisa. And one thing I loved about the entire film is how every character that you thought was one way, by the end of the film, you're like, is a complete other character. And that for me is my go-to all for any role that comes my way. Like, those kinds of roles just, the juiciest things. Aisha and Nafsi for me was another one, even if it was emotionally so draining and growing.
I loved Nafsi. I loved it.
Right?
Yes.
I mean, this is the direction we're supposed to be going. This is it. Those kind of roles are the ones that really give me a lot of, I feel very challenged by them, and I think that's what I appreciate. And I also love the fact that I think that as human beings, we're not one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever a character like that comes my way, I'm like, yes, welcome. This is the human experience. This is exactly what we are.
Yeah.
Every day you make a choice, and that a collection of those choices is what makes you who you are, right?
You are not right, okay? It's the...
What, my hormones? Are you fucking mad?
Because Nandi was the first time Nandi's the first character that pushed me to really slap someone. And I was like, oh no. Once that door was open, I was like, oh crap. Now I just want to slap everyone. But it made me think about how when people play, for instance, very violent or very psychotic roles,
yes.
As human beings, it made me question, what is the difference between me and this other person? Is it a chemical in the brain, or is it choice?
Yes.
Is it every day that you have this choice to slap the everything out of anyone who pisses you off, or you maintain, shut up and just be calm, you know? Like, those are just, I keep wondering, I'm like, is it how you were raised? Is it this? Those are the kind of questions that I keep asking myself. So I tend to be drawn to those kinds of roles. So to answer your question in a very long and short way.
It's good. I mean, you've given a very healthy answer, because at the end of the day, what you said, I pick up also, we are multifaceted. And I am, like, even if you look at some of the short films we've done with our organization, they tend to be very indie, not in terms of the production process, but they tend also to be very indie in how storytelling is done, because we have a sense of realism in projecting certain themes. So someone may watch it and be like, apana, this is dark, or it's too relatable. And usually when someone says something is dark or something is graphic, I'm not just saying graphic for the sake of being graphic, but in terms of portraying certain themes as they would appear in real life, people kind of take a step back, because it becomes relatable. We tend to see, and big up to all the people making films, I think the more the merrier, but we tend to see a lot of generic output in terms of storytelling and in terms of even comedy, which, by the way, I've never done comedy. Maybe one day I should do comedy, which tends to be slapstick. I think there's room for comedy that can also be dark. And I've not seen Kenyans exploring dark comedy.
Yeah, and I mean, you just need to go to Twitter and know how dark we are. I mean, we're the kings of dark humor.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. We're not okay. Like, we're not fine. We need some help.
And you know, dark humor also happens in real life, but it's not even humor, because it comes off as it's real. Like, let me just give you a quick story. There's a time when I was younger. One of the guys who lived in our neighborhood was and now this is again mental health, dumped by a girlfriend of his, and as the story went, he alikunywa dawa ya panya. Because in hell, he wanted to, like, he was like, if I can't be with this girlfriend. So anyway, long story short, he was rushed to hospital. And the doctor who was there, actually, they managed to revive him. And the doctor said, now, like, when he was back to his senses and everything, the doctor told him, by the way, mtu hadailiutingi na maji. Next time, kama ulikuwa unataka kujiua, mtu hadailiutingi. Actually, we saved you, Julie, dilute na maji. So you may portray that in film and someone is like, I know, in this world where we are so sensitive nowadays, someone may say, now you're making fun of people who are suicidal. Yet you're not making fun. You're presenting a reality. And I think that's where storytelling gets its biggest... power. You're not proselytizing people to believe something, but rather you are saying, look at this reality. What you think about it, what decisions you make, niwewe.
So anyway.
Which school did you go to, high school?
I went to Consolata.
Okay.
For primary school, and then high school, I was homeschooled.
Oh, nice. That's rare in Kenya. I don't know about theater. Can you maybe share? I've not seen much of your theater work, or is it something you prefer not to do, or is it something that we don't have access to?
It's just because you don't see it because it's non-existent. I don't have any.
Okay.
One play.
Okay.
I was a narrator for it.
Yes.
It was a musical, actually. That was when I was still trying to get my feet into the whole film industry.
Yes.
But it was called Rain Queen. It was many years ago. That's about it.
But you're super busy. I feel like you're so busy.
Am I?
Yeah. I mean, can you just, let's talk about the elephant in the room, or should we say the blue pill and red pill in the room, that's The Matrix, the fourth movie that we were all thinking would never happen. And guess what? We have a fellow Kenyan in it. Could you just tell us something about your experience working on that set, and maybe also Sense8, because I guess it's the same director.
Yeah, it is. It was the same director. It was the same director. So maybe I can start.
Hello again.
Hi. Look, I feel like I owe you an apology.
No, not at all.
I do, because I haven't been able to stop thinking about what you said and how it applied to my own life. You spoke so beautifully.
I can start with Sense8, because that was now my first international.
I liked Zakia.
I loved her. In fact, that was one of the characters I was going to say that I absolutely loved. I feel like she forced me to expand my mind. I feel like I was so ignorant to so many things until I met her. I was like, okay, right. I know nothing in this world. Yeah. That's another favorite character of mine. So I think that it was, I don't know why I don't even know where to begin, because I feel like it changed so much of my life. Being on those productions, because it was a dream of mine, obviously. I'm very big on visualizing and on writing down what you want for yourself. I really am big on that. And I've seen so much happen for me. It takes patience and persistence, but I feel like it gets you very clear on the vision that you want for yourself, you know? So that being my first international series was very intimidating, but also I loved the fact that the cast, the crew, the directors, everyone was so warm and welcoming that it just made me feel like, oh, okay, everything I've been doing anyway in Kenya was just preparing me for this. It's just that it's a big stage. It's just that everything is big. Everything is just, there are no limits to what they want to do and how they want to expand. And then of course with the writing and having the autistics, right, and how their brains operate, it just let me know how unlimited we are as human beings. That's one. When I got into The Matrix, now that was a whole other different level, because what that taught me is that there's absolutely nothing that I am doing that someone else doesn't have the same power to do.
Yes.
Meeting these really huge stars and just realizing you're human like me. Like there's nothing, there was no heirs, you know, they're just able to create these amazing films and draw people to them at a scale that is so large because they're so deeply focused on what they're doing.
Yeah.
It's like you can just tell that it's undeniable, from the art person to the sound person to every single actor. Everyone is so deeply dedicated to what they're here to do that one, you cannot fuck around. Two, it just inspires you to just realize, oh my gosh, what am I doing here? Then you're like, oh, I do deserve to be here because I have put in the work.
What you're saying makes a lot of sense. Sorry, we have 5 minutes left, but
we can always
do this again. I think we've already shared so much that can be currency to even young actors, young men and young women. Especially now in Kenya, where it's like the generation, as I keep using this referral, the Gen Z, Gen X and the early millennials kind of opened up the space. Mm-hmm. Like you cannot mm-hmm. compare where we are at now to say maybe 2009-ish when maybe we're having MTV, Sugar and the likes.
Yeah. So the first, I would say, lessons that I've learned in the long run is, one, definitely patience. Second, in the beginning especially, take every job like it's your biggest job, right? Use it as practice, use it as a way to train yourself, use it as a way to make a name for yourself. I don't think that you should have too much pace about it in the beginning, especially where the industry is right now. I think there's about to be a lot of competition for a lot of actors.
Yeah.
Male, female, doesn't matter. Mm. And I think that there's a certain, not entitlement, but I think that there's a certain humility that has to come with that, right? You're not going to get there immediately. You might, and that's wonderful.
Yeah.
But should you not? And even if you do get there immediately, that character that you build in that moment is what's going to take you way further than anything yes. else.
Yeah, yeah.
Second, start singing. Don't be out there running for the high life, you know? Don't be out there trying to prove that you're an actor and therefore you are this wealthy. We're not there yet in Kenya, so calm down, okay? No one even expects it from you. Like, just chill.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, if you can get a passive income, right?
Yeah.
I really think that those are things that I wish that I learned when I was much younger and didn't feel so much pressure. I gave myself the pressure and I don't think we should have it ever, honestly. Yeah. Yeah, I think those are my two strongest things. Yeah, and also just if you can find ways to learn, if you can find workshops, if you can use movies. I saw a clip that you put on Instagram that really was so spot on for me because I know I used that as training myself. I would find series and movies, short films, whatever it is, that I can envision myself being in.
Yeah,
and I would watch them over and over and over again, and ask myself questions like, was it the director's choice, or the actor's choice? You know, you know, what got them there? Those are things that helped me and continue to help me learn.
Okay,
and, learn patience and get your money right. Just save.
Yeah, and Mumbi, like when I come back to Kenya, we are doing a project for. We're having a long-standing creative education project because it's part of our mandate as Mau Mau Arts. So would you be open to kind of coming over? We're actually doing this from Noah Gallery.
Okay.
Gary Drive with Kate Snow, who you probably know from Rafiki Hub.
Yes.
So would you be open to kind of chiming in on the creative education? Because I feel most of these creative education is a factor of experience more so than the theoretical aspects, which is important, but
it
would be of value. Would you be open to like one day and giving a talk to some of the actors?
Absolutely. Yes, I'd be honored to.
Thank you so much for joining us and for watching. Please remember to subscribe to our channel. And if you would like to see any features, mention them in the comments.